It's gotten to the point that the fire that's absent from the pulpits today is telling on the pews. You could have a church of thousands and God's presence not be there. Numbers don't tell it. You could be 3,000 strong and a half inch deep. It doesn't mean anything. And a good wind that would come along and blow the 3,000 down because they have no root in them. Religious tapestries that we've come to be entertained by rather than empowered by. And all these kind of things are wearing off. And there's a heart cry coming out from the church saying, God, we need you. Got to have you. Don't want to move. Don't want to sing another song unless you inhabit it. What is God's move today? What kind of move is God involved in today? What kind of river is really beginning to flow? Where is it that God is doing the work? Where is it that God's doing? And he's doing it right here. He's raising up. He's looking for. He's seeking a people that are hungry and thirsty for him, his presence, who he is, not what he does, just who he is. And he's raising up a bunch of Moseses behind, a bunch of people with the heart of Moses that say, God, we're not moving unless you're here. That's when God says, yes. I've been waiting on that. God's crying for intimacy. There comes a point in time when maturity should beckon us and that maturity should call us up. There has to come a point in time that your heart cries out for something more than just another demonstration of his power. That you have to come to the point that you're looking for a demonstration of who he is and begin to say, God, show me who you are. God, take the veil away. God, take away what separates us. Let me see you. When you say, show me your glory, you're saying, God, I want to see you. God wants to be just as intimate with you as you desire to be intimate with him. God wants to call you up into his presence. And I promise you that right now that there is a hunger stirring within God's people. There's a hunger stirring to see the glory of God again. You know, I'm of the opinion that really we're not satisfied until we move into his presence. Why? Because we were made to live in it. And unless we move in the presence of God, we'll never be satisfied. The power of God won't be enough. David said this. He says, Thou, Lord, you said, seek my face. Your face, Lord, will I seek. Now, who said it? God said it. David answered it, but God said it. God said, seek my face. What does that mean to seek somebody's face? The word seek means to pursue. You see, sometimes we're sitting back waiting for spirituality to happen and it doesn't. Spirituality happens when you seek. Holiness doesn't just poof in your life. And too often we're waiting because we see demonstrations of the power. We see hands laid on somebody and somebody hit the ground. But I promise you, when you get up, you better be seeking what put you down. And it just doesn't materialize on you. You have to pursue it. Now we're dealing with the face. Seek my face. Well, what's face mean? When you look it up, face means presence. It means to seek the presence of God. And at that point in time, you seek the most intimate part of God. Rather than trying to manipulate something out of his heaven At that point in time, you come into His presence and there's no deals to be cut. You just say, God, I just wanted to be with you. You can have a great communion with God, sit down scrubbing your toilet, getting all that stuff cleaned up, and all of a sudden the glory of God touch you with thanksgiving, and you just be praising Him, thanking Him, and be worshiping Him and all that kind of stuff, and all of a sudden you're weeping tears into the toilet. And you're on your knees and saying, God, thank you. I can remember when I was here drunk, throwing my guts up, and I thank you, God, that you've delivered me from that. I can remember when I knelt here in a different way than when I kneel here now. Oh, you can practice the presence of God anywhere. When it comes to going behind and beyond the veil, and when it takes, when it comes time for you to enter into the presence of God, you're going to have to go there yourself. You're the one that has to enter in and say, God, you're my God. You were my daddy's God. You were my granddaddy's God. You were my grandmother's God. But today I make you mine. See, religion won't satisfy the depths of the human heart. That's why people keep turning the church into a revolving door. Why they don't walk out of sin and stay out of it. Why issues keep revolving in their life. Why? Because they've just tried it through religion's means. They've yet to walk into the relationship that truly sets them free. They've yet to experience the deeper relational touch of God. God, I have to have you lest I die. It's time for the church to move beyond the entertainment age that people have. Well, they bless me. Yeah, but do they take you behind the veil? Does it press us into the gloried presence of God? Or did it just say, that was neat? What is he looking for? He's looking for a place where his presence is welcomed. And he will inhabit it. He will shake it. He will change it. People will run to it and flock to it, and it will change the region that it's in. That's what it will do. He's looking for a place where he can sit and abide and be welcomed and comfortable, where truth is proclaimed and where word is unadulterated and unmixed, and he can sit into the midst and people want to get close to him. God's crying for intimacy.